everyone. It's so good to have you. My name is Maria, and I am the Vice Dean of Teaching and Learning at the University. So it's my office that you've been dealing with to register. And I take it that everybody here has registered. Yes? Give yourselves a round of applause. Registration is not the easiest process. I can tell you that it gets a bit easier now. Who of you comes from Johannesburg? Whoa, that's quite a lot of people from Joburg. Yes, Joburg. Who of you comes from outside of Joburg? Oh, wow. Welcome to Josie. Let's give them a round of applause. They made it here. And so you guys are going to have lots and lots of fun far away from mom and dad. Yes. The next thing is, I would like you to all give yourselves another huge round of applause. Before you do that, why? Because you guys made it through matric. You made it through the long holidays and didn't get too bored. You made it through the anxious process of getting to UJ, and you registered. So you guys are the top of the top. You've made it to UJ. Well done. Give yourselves a round of applause. Okay, so many of you might be feeling a little bit worried about the uncertainties on campus. One of the really nice things about UJ is, firstly, our fees are not as high as other places. And secondly, we have a lot of funding, particularly for missing middle students. So when people say UJ was not at the front of the political debate, it's partly because many of our students were actually better taken care of. So last year we raised 100 million rand for missing middle students. So we really take your education seriously. We want you to succeed. We want to help you. So the places that you need to come to are multiple. First, there's the SRC that can help you. Secondly, come to the faculty office and ask for help if you're getting stuck with your fees or with any of your registration. We really don't want your finances to hold you back from succeeding. For all of you, it's taken a lot of work. It's taken dedication from your families to get here. And we want you to succeed, to get through this process as quickly and as smoothly as possible. Okay. The next thing is that while some universities are very established and to a degree are very posh, like the place where I used to study, Wits, that bunch just down the road that we don't talk about, and my husband still works there, so it's a very tense thing in our family, we have constant competitions. At UJ, we are a new and vibrant university. So a lot of things are less set in stone here. We try to do a lot of different things in our teaching. We are constantly growing, expanding, and trying to make ourselves look better, perform better, and service you, our students, better. You really are our big focus. And everything we try to do is to try and make your experience fun, but also academically stimulating and interesting. Now, I have a PhD in a very understudied area. I look at world religions. Some people say to me, what on earth is the point of studying what other people believe? Well, this comes to the bigger question of what is the point of doing a BA?
One of the biggest success stories of the 21st century has been Facebook and Google. Now, behind Facebook and Google was somebody who wrote nice computer programming. But what's far more important was that somebody understood what we didn't know we wanted. And the same thing with WhatsApp, and the same thing with much of the innovation that's taking place today. It's all things that 5 years nobody had thought of. The cutting edge of the 21st century is about creativity, management of people, and new ideas. These are the three things that computers cannot do. And you need to understand people to manage them. You need to understand people to predict what they might want and don't yet know they want. And the third thing is we need people to make all our technology accessible and to actually analyze all the data that comes at us. Doing a degree in the arts or humanities is the degree that is going to best place you to be on the cutting edge. So, for a long time, the CEO of Anglo was somebody who had a BA degree. Why? Because a BA helps you to see the world from all sorts of different angles. It helps you to understand that history and politics and what people believe and how we think logically about our world are all the things that you will need to know going forward. So when your family say to you, but what are you going to do? You say to your grandma, grandma, when you were born, was there Bookface, as the old people like to call it? Not Facebook, Bookface. And granny says, no. And granny doesn't actually even know how to use Bookface. And you say to her, well, that's exactly the world I'm preparing for. I'm preparing for a world we don't yet know. And the best way for me to do that is to understand how people think, how to manage them, and how to creatively solve problems. So you are not doing a degree that when I went to university, we used to refer to as a BA, which stands for either bugger all or brilliantly academic. I go with the brilliantly academic, but actually very useful. And you're going to find out how useful your degree is as you go along and when you get into the world of work. The next thing is that your parents are going to say, but how is this preparing you for the world of work? When you get into your third year, we have something called the senior student experience. And we're going to give you lots of help and support on how to put your CV together, how to look for a job, and how to prepare yourself for the world of work. We are not only interested in your academic ability, but also in your development as a person. Right, we were going to have a very fancy slideshow, but the technical people are very busy and they haven't yet arrived. So the next thing before we get to that presentation that I want to talk to you about is our library. We have two of our librarians here with us. Do you want to stand up and wave your hands? Okay, right. When you were at school, you probably either never went to the library or didn't read books. Our library is not like other libraries. It looks as beautiful as this auditorium. It has lots of study spaces, breakaway spaces, and it has the most amazing collection of books. And books are really nice, especially stories. So, I would really like to encourage you to go to the library. The librarians are infinitely patient and are there to help you. And don't tell your other lecturers I said this, but even if you never take out a book to do with communications, and you take out things you're really interested in, there are lots of lovely novels. Go and read those. And when your mom says you're not studying, you say to her, the vice dean told us that the first part of studying is learning to read, and to read well and quickly. So mom, I am busy improving my reading speed. I'm studying. Okay, that doesn't just apply to reading Facebook and WhatsApp, okay? I mean, like, read a book, you know? We have lots and lots of books, e-books, which you can download. And as you go through your orientation in the first week or two, you're going to be introduced to the library. And they will show you how you can download e-books as well. Now, for a lot of you, being on campus is where you're going to have access to Wi-Fi. And one of the other really cool things about the library is that it's one of our really good Wi-Fi hotspots. Now, some people say that Facebook and WhatsApp and all of that is not so good. I'm of the firm opinion that spending some time every day on WhatsApp is really important. Following your friends on Facebook is a good thing. You don't want to be stuck at university completely isolated. Okay. All right, I have to stay in one place. The cameraman will be happy. Okay, making friends at university is not always the easiest thing. You had a good friendship network at school. You come here, the classes are big. You can never really talk to the lecturer. And here we go. Yay. Thank you. Strict instructions, don't stand in front. Cool. So, what I want to encourage you to do is not spend all your time on Facebook, but, okay, yeah, okay, now. Now it's not much.
Is it too late? No.
Yeah. Okay. Is that okay? Yes, that's good. Thank you. But also to make friends and to stay connected with your friends. So what I'd like to do now is to ask you to speak to the person behind you and say to them, congratulations for getting to UJ. My name is Make a Friend. Telephone numbers that you can be on WhatsApp. Guys, dating starts from today. Let's be honest, okay? You're here to meet people. The next thing I want to talk about is how to succeed in your degree. Now, some of you might have read this book by a guy called Malcolm Gladwell. It's called The Outliers. And basically all of you sitting here are outliers. You are people who have performed way above the average. Quite a few of you will have come in the top 10 or top 1% of your school. And one of the hardest things you're going to have to deal with in the next 6 months is that you are sitting with a group of people who are just as brilliant and good as you are. So where you used to get 90% and 80% at school, you're now going to be getting like 60%. And the first thing I want to tell you is that is very normal. Everybody sees their marks go down somewhat from what they were at school. Firstly, the work is harder. It's a different type of work. And you're trying to orientate yourself in a different space. But most importantly, the standard has gone up. You are now competing with a whole lot of other people who are particularly good at what they do. So, Malcolm Gladwell's whole book on the outliers is what makes people successful. And he looked at Bill Gates and Mozart and all sorts of other people. And his key idea is that to succeed in something, you've got to put in 10,000 hours of work. So, you've got to strategize the partying, the dating, and the working. They're all important. But if you want to succeed, you've got to put the legwork in. The next is there's a certain degree of lucky opportunities. And some of you are here because you have got NISFAS funding or you've got SRC funding. So something has worked out for your good. And the idea is successful people take the opportunities and make the most of them. The next thing he says is that we all have a degree of cultural legacy. And one of the things we are passionate about at UJ is to really get people to understand the world that they live in. So we don't really want to spend a lot of time teaching you about a lot of dead old white men that lived in Europe. We want us to look at what does it mean to live in South Africa? What's our cultural legacy? What is the knowledge that we come with when we come to a space of learning? And all of you have got cultural legacy. You know stuff about the world. That's how you got to be here. Use it. Use your initiatives. The next thing he says that also plays something of a role is your upbringing. But he doesn't see that as particularly important. It's a small part of your success. So he says it doesn't really matter where you come from. To succeed, you need to put in the hours. And finally, he says there's something called timing. Sometimes people are successful because, like Bill Gates, they invent the right thing at just the right time. But his idea is that most of the time, you can actually make the timing for yourself. So the take-home message is put in 100,000 hours. But I've spoken about this a little bit already, but the way to succeed at university is to understand that it's a bit like going from playing soccer to playing tennis. It's still a ball sport, but it's very different. So many of you may have to change your study strategies and techniques. What worked for school doesn't always work for here. Now, my brother is an incredibly successful lawyer. He makes literally millions of rands a year and works for one of the most prestigious legal firms. And And he started life out doing a BA. He majored in history and classics and then went on to do his LLB. And when he got to university, my brother is a bit taller than me, he had this short little girlfriend that he made like in the first week. And she was repeating first year because she hadn't got into psychology and she wanted to become a child psychologist. And so he said to her when he got this first exam, this first essay that he had to write, said, so how do you go about writing an essay? So she said, no, it's easy. You just get the essay assignment the day before, and then you go to the library at 9 o'clock and you get all the books and then you read all day and then you write all night, and then at 12 o'clock the next day you hand the essay in. So my brother thought, oh wait, cool, I can do this. So he goes to the library, he does the reading, he starts writing, it's 12 o'clock at night, he's getting really tired. We hear creak creak on the stairs, he goes downstairs, makes coffee, comes back up, writes a bit more, and then he decides, I sugar, stuff this, I'm not going to make this. He switches off his light, goes to sleep, and never hands in the essay. He gets to third year, he's majoring in history, and the tutor gives him back his essay and he says, I'm giving you 74%, not 75. Now remember, at university, a distinction is 75 and above, so that's what you're aiming for. And he says, because you owe me an essay from first year. So my brother was really upset. But after this experience of essay writing, he realized that he needed more than a day to write an essay. So firstly, it's very different from school. And secondly, be careful of the advice that you get, especially from people that are trying to impress you. Your most important tool at the university is going to be your study guide. You get a study guide for every one of your modules, and it will tell you exactly what you need to submit, how long your essays need to be, what format your exams are going to be, etc. Your study guide becomes your Bible. In most subjects, it will be online, and you will have a presentation just now about how to access the UJ online services. The next thing is, how much work should you be putting in? You should be spending a minimum of 8 hours a week on each module, okay? So, yeah, it's just short of 40 hours a week. Probably 3 hours are spent in lectures, 1 hour on your tutorials, and the rest of the time is for you to work on your own. Of course, close to an essay or close to the exams, you've got to be putting in a little bit more work than just 8 hours. So a big part is that your academic life happens outside the lecture hall. You are not going to get away with just going to lectures. You've got to do work outside. And to just work on your own is a very ineffective way of trying to study. So go to lectures. The way to make it at university is really to know what is expected of you and try not to be this dude in the picture, running around, being late, harassed, and never being on top of everything. Next week, when you get your study guides, go home, diarize the dates. Know when things are due. Know when the test is coming. Know the venues for your lectures. I tell you, if you get a degree at UJ, there should be a special little section that says a degree in mapping, because UJ is a very complicated space to work out, and this campus is very confusing. So, once you've found where everything is, make sure you put in your diary when you're supposed to do what. Now, this is really, really important. In order to be able to write an exam, you must have a term average of 40%. If it's less than 40, you cannot write the exam and you will fail. Once you've written the exam, you must get an average of 50% or more in the exam, and your overall average of the term work and the exam must be 50% or more. So if you go into an exam with 42%, you will have to get 58% in the exam in order to pass. So you need to check your marks and know what your average is. You will see these marks on the student online system called Blackboard, which they're going to tell you more about. Now, the next thing is just so that everybody's on the same page. Your BA degree is over 3 years. Most of you will do 6 first year modules. A module is for a semester. The first semester is from February to June, and the second semester is from the end of July to November. So you either think about your work as per semester, i.e. per module, or over the year. So you need to do 6 first year modules plus English. Some of you may not have to do English, but most people have to do English, which is a fourth subject. In second year, you will do 6 second year modules and 1 first year module or subject. Sorry, 2 first year modules or subjects. And then when you get to third year, I think some of this is wrong. Third year you will do 4 third year modules and 1 second year module. Right, so it's 4 subjects in first year, 4 subjects in second year, 3 subjects in third year. Okay, so you must keep track that you are passing all of this. Now, you need to remember that we only count the modules that you've passed. You need to pass 60% of your modules in order to make it to the second year of study. If you only pass 50%, in other words, you only pass 4 out of your 8 modules, you are allowed to repeat the year, but you are considered a first year student. If you pass between 41 and 49% of your modules, in other words, 3 out of the 8 modules, you get an academic warning, and then you have to pass everything in order to continue. If you only pass 40%, in other words, only 2 out of the 8 modules, you are academically excluded. You cannot come back to the university. There is something called an F7 appeal that you can make. Let's say you got very, very ill, and that's why you couldn't write the exams, and we will review your case. But basically, if you do not pass 50% of your modules, you fall into a serious academic risk category and are at risk of not being allowed to return. The next thing is that you might go to a subject that you thought sounded interesting, but when you get there, it's actually really boring. You are allowed to change subjects in the first 2 weeks. So you can find out from a friend that my subject, religion studies, is really interesting. So you can leave politics or whatever and come to religion studies. And that won't cost you anything. You can also cancel a module or your whole degree by the 15th of February and you won't pay anything.
Cancel a module before the end of March, then you are liable for 50%, and after March you are liable for all the fees. You cannot cancel a subject 21 days before the exam.
It will appear as a fail on your academic transcript, which is not a good thing to have. An important tip for success at university is ask your lecturers and your tutors. We are really happy to help you. Email us, speak to us after a lecture, go to the consultation times. Very often the lecturers will feel a bit intimidating. Remember, they are just as intimidated as you. They are standing in front of 600 people they don't know. So if they seem a bit gruff, it's because they're nervous, but don't tell them that I said so. Go and speak to them. They want to help you. We want to see you succeed. And then, as I said when I began, do fun things in your time here. Join a sports club, join the choir, make friends. That's the end of my presentation. We're now going to have a really super presentation by an alumni from the university, Mrs. Zandele, and I don't have my glasses, Zandele, sorry, Mondabi. And she is going to come and tell you about how she succeeded. While we mic her up, dating is important. Turn around and exchange those telephone numbers.